Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Seth Greenland, has written I Regret Everything, a love story. And it is. It is a book that you don't want to end. And it's published by Europa Books. Welcome, Seth.
Hello, Connie. Thanks for having me.
Well, it's my pleasure. And as I said to you, I couldn't almost bring myself to end the book. But let's tell our friends about your characters. Jinx is the name of the man as a poet, and his real name is Jeremy.
Jeremy Best is the character's
name. And he's an attorney for Trust and Estates, 33 years old, and she is 19. Not such a big schism for those of us who have a much bigger schism. And she's the daughter of the head of the senior partner mm-hmm. of the law firm with a very interesting name,
Spaulding Simonson is
yes.
her name.
But her father calls her Spall.
Spall, short yeah. for Spaulding.
And she has had a lot of emotional problems.
She had a mental breakdown 6 months before the action of the story starts, and she meets Jeremy at a point where she's still feeling the effects of that and is in a very vulnerable emotional place.
It's a very New York type story. Parents
it is, yeah.
divorced.
Mm-hmm.
Mother kept the great big three-bedroom apartment on the river and has had two marriages since.
And the father remarried, has a second wife, lives in Connecticut with two sons from the second marriage.
One of whom, Marshall, is more up Spaulding's type.
Marshall's a 12-year-old wrestling with his sexual identity and being a sensitive kid in the suburbs with parents who don't understand him. And these two find common ground together.
Because after a certain point, Spaulding has gone to her father and said, I can't live with my mother anymore. I don't like the man she's going with. He is Doda, I believe his name is. He's not my type, and I feel awkward.
And she's allergic to her mother's cats, so it's a terrible situation in the apartment. She asks if she can go live with her father in Connecticut. The father is reluctant to have her live there because emotionally she's such a handful, but he ultimately agrees to have her there for the summer, and Spaulding decamps to Connecticut and winds up commuting into the city to take a poetry workshop at Barnard College and to work as a gopher in her father's law firm that summer, which is where she encounters Jeremy Best, who's the other main character in the story.
And the book is written in her voice a chapter, his voice another. And she's already checked him out as, who is he?
He is someone who had a promising career as a poet that was cut short because of some behavioral things that he engaged in, and he abandoned his career in the literary world to become an attorney. He's become a trust and estates attorney, and he's pretty much forgotten about the literary side of his life, and his encounter with Spaulding forces him to take another look at that and motivates him in that area.
Would you just read this paragraph here that I have marked?
I would be
because
happy to.
It is so typical of people who write.
She's barged into his office at the law firm, and this is their first encounter. They haven't met before this. She says to him, I read your poem in the Paris Review, she said. These are eight words guaranteed to freeze the blood of any poet while he awaits the follow-up. Whether the verdict is positive or negative, one develops an instant case of acute stress response, otherwise known as fight or flight, and further brain activity ceases until the situation is resolved. I liked it, or I hated it, doesn't matter. What matters, and matters deeply, is the stating of some, any, opinion. It violates the laws of the universe to say, I read your poem, followed by nothing. This is to stare into the yawning void itself. That's why I came to talk to you, but if you're really tied up, we'll do it another time. Okay, so I waited. She placed her hands behind her neck and with an outward flick of her fingers, delicately fluffed her ambrosial curls. It was good. I could have smoked a cigarette, he says.
Anybody who does any sort of a, whether it's a column or whatever, that is the epitome of it.
Writers need to have the response just to be reminded that they exist.
Yeah.
They put these things out in the world, and the silence is often deafening. And if somebody says, oh, I read it, well, that's such a provocative statement until they conclude with, I liked it, I hated it, this was my reaction or that was my reaction. But just to say I read it and leave it hanging, if you want to torture a writer, that's the way to do it.
Absolutely. That's the way it begins. And he suddenly is attracted to her, but in an off way. After all, she's 19, and he knows she's the boss's daughter, and he feels he's up for being made a partner.
Yeah, he's a fifth-year associate, and he's in his early 30s, and he knows that getting involved with the boss's daughter, Spaulding, would be a situation that could not possibly end well, and he tries to keep her from pursuing her interest in him, and he really tries pretty hard, actually, and eventually he fails because he couldn't not, or it wouldn't be a love story, but he makes a manly effort to keep her at bay.
And she keeps after him in a very intelligent way.
She is a talented artist manqué herself. Because she's 19, she's not particularly accomplished, but if you look at certain young people, I think anybody who teaches writing or teaches painting will see there are certain students who really have what appears to be talent. And this young person looks like she may be talented. And she's a talented sketch artist. She's a talented poet for somebody the age she is. So he's intrigued by her. And she's funny. She's got a good sense of humor. And really wants a mentor in him, because she has discovered that he had published a book of poems under another name, and essentially wants this attractive, talented guy to pay attention to her. And he just doesn't have time for her because he's
careful,
very preoccupied about with other things going on in his life, one of which becomes quite serious. And he's, as you say, careful because he knows where it could lead, which is the land of many regrets.
And as a result, her way of getting to him is, will you speak to my class at Barnard?
Exactly. Which is a sop to any writer's ego. Will you come and talk to us? Will you speak in public? Will you share your wisdom? And of course, he can't resist that, so he does that, and it makes him even a bigger deal in her eyes. Actually, it backfires in that sense, and they keep drawing closer and closer as he resists and she pursues, until finally something happens and he finds himself in a situation that he probably should not be in.
But during that period, he has felt something in his hip or in his back there.
He discovered something at a doctor's visit. The doctor was examining his neck, doing this kind of thing that any doctor will do to you when you have a physical, and the doctor found something suspicious, and that suspicious thing turns out to be cancer. And without giving away too many details, it's fairly advanced, and he needs to deal with that problem in his life, and it's one of the things that's keeping him quite distracted. And it manifests in stage four, and the last thing he really wants to do is deal with the boss's daughter, given what else he's got on his plate.
And now he's got the choice, chemotherapy or nothing, really.
Yeah.
She's smart enough to start doing research. And I mean, I have known people who had that choice and they ended up with a Chinese herbologist, mm-hmm. and it's 5 years later. So you don't know, damned if you do and damned if you don't.
That's a very, very difficult choice to make. And he takes a traditional route in the beginning, and without giving too much away, he then investigates some other possibilities, and we follow him on this journey that Spaulding ends up becoming involved with.
And also, her father has Edward P. Edward P., has bought a Tesla. And it's like his masculinity is in that car. And I have known a few people in this city who have bought Teslas. And I mean, it is, I don't know what is that car. I will never probably ever drive one. But it's something that is magic to them. Forgive me, but do you have a Tesla?
I do not have a Tesla. I think Teslas are the car you drive if you want to be good to the earth, but let people know you could afford to be driving a BMW.
Right. Well, in this case, she takes the car, and she doesn't have a driver's license.
That's correct.
And drives from Connecticut to New York. And suddenly, she's desperate. And she sees, she calls up our friend Jeremy, and she says, I need you. I'm in trouble. Please drive me back to Connecticut.
And he makes the decision to do that, and they get to Connecticut, where a spasm of violence occurs that he needs to come in and be the hero, which is not a role in which he's comfortable. He's not a heroic guy. He's not a traditional leading man type in that sense. And he saves her life.
But she has already had a run-in with this creep,
yes,
this man, and nobody would believe her. They thought she was making up, go back to your analyst, go back to Dr. Margaret, what have you. And I felt so sorry for her, because there's nothing worse than trying to tell someone, I'm not making it up.
And Jeremy sees, indeed, she hasn't been making it up, and the situation becomes very, very fraught, and he saves the day. And
that's the turning point, I would say, in
their
relationship.
Very much so. And after that happens, it takes the relationship to another level, and he sees something in her at that moment that makes all the defenses he's constructed vanish, essentially. And they, at that point, get involved with each other romantically.
And he has become invaluable to the law firm. Why? Because Edward P. has put on him, go to this client whose wife has put on him a real thing. She has taken one of his famous paintings, and I guess it's very abstract, etc., and she's copied it and put it on the wall and gone off.
Well, what's happened, this was actually based on a story that a trust and estates attorney once told me at a party. He had a client whose wife was a very talented artist, and the client was a collector and had very expensive paintings on the wall. And I can't recall who the artist was. Say it was Paul Klee, which is the one I used in the book. This guy's wife, he kept her on a very tight leash financially. She needed money. She got in business with some shady characters and found herself in about $1 million hole, and wound up giving these loan sharks one of her husband's very, very valuable paintings, which she was able to duplicate herself and put the fake on the wall. And this trust and estates guy told me this at a party, and I thought, this is just too rich. I have to use this in something. And that's where that came from. And it's a big plot point in the book, and it comes from reality, as it happens.
And the way he tells this to the husband seals his place in legal history.
The husband is very grateful at the way Jeremy handles it and says, I would love to do a favor for you in the future, because Jeremy's able to get the painting back for him. And he winds up doing a favor that figures into the climax of the book.
There's another part that was there, and I was curious about why it came out. And so I will ask the author about his arranging for a friend to buy a house that Jeremy wanted, that was out in Montauk.
Jeremy's moral compass gets thrown out of whack with his cancer diagnosis, because he doesn't realize, he doesn't know how long he's got to live. And as a result, he makes a decision that perhaps he might not have made had he been healthy. He enlists a friend to help him buy the house in an estate for which he is the executor. And there in New York State, and I think most other states, is a statute against self-dealing. It's called self-dealing when a lawyer does something like that. And he's been a by-the-book attorney until this point, and he wants a house in Montauk, and this is the likeliest way for him to get it. And he does a bad thing, and we find out later whether or not it catches up to him. But he makes a sketchy decision based on fear.
I must have missed that line in the book. But how did Edward find out about it?
The people who were the what do you call the people who were inheriting from a property, the inheritors.
Yeah.
The inheritors figured out what was going on because they looked at who the house was being sold to, because they were going to get the money in the sale, and they initiated a suit against Jeremy and against the law firm. And that's how Jeremy's bosses found out what he was doing.
Oh, because again, you have that, the summer entertainment of the interns on the ship, on the boat that's going around New York Harbor. Well, who has worked someplace in New York that doesn't have that harbor trail? Yeah.
Yeah, that's a big part of New York law firm life. Every summer, summer associates, they're called, come into the city and they work at law firms and get large amounts of money thrown at them in the hopes that these students who are from the most competitive law schools in the country will come work at these firms for crazy amounts of money for youngsters after they get out of law school. And there's a sequence in the book that's set on one of these summer intern cruises. And they do all kinds of things, take them on cruises and to Yankee games and to, you know, all kinds of things to make their law firm look like the best, most fun place to work.
What part of this book was Seth's life?
Well, when I was in my 30s, like Jeremy, was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, so I was writing that from a very, very personal place. And I nearly became an attorney. And my closest friend from growing up, who's still one of my closest friends, and my wife are both attorneys. It's a world that I knew a lot about, I'd never written about. And I wanted to use this material that I had and had never dipped into before. So the book itself is not literally autobiographical, but I've had some of the experiences that were elucidated in the book.
Yeah. The girl, how does she relate?
She's entirely made up.
Yeah. Because, again, we should tell our friends in the audience, you wrote Big Love.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wrote Big Love, which is about very, very non-traditional love, being about polygamy. And the age difference here is it's 14 years, and it's I guess that's a lot in the eyes of a lot
isn't.
Of people.
And
yeah, I don't have that much to say about that subject.
Yeah. Besides that, there have been some other shows that I could mention that you have done on television, mm-hmm. which are.
I wrote for a show called Arliss and Big Love, as we said, and then a lot of pilots and things like that.
Where'd you go to school?
I was an undergraduate at Connecticut College in New London, Connecticut, a small private school, and I have an MFA from NYU.
And life has been here in California.
I lived in New York until I was in my early 40s, and I was doing a lot of work for Hollywood Studios at that point, and my wife and I had young kids, and we thought it would be a good idea to come to California, so we've been out here since then.
You've noticed that I am not giving away the end of this
Thank
book.
You for not doing that.
All right, because, as I said, my pleasure in this book is such that I have really recommended it to other people, and I don't want to, I may in a column give it away, but I won't on air.
I really appreciate that. It's one of those things where you set up a situation where it's pretty important how it resolves. So it's good to not know, I think, when you begin the book. So thanks for not saying anything.
Absolutely. Absolutely, Seth. And I thank you for it. Let's talk about this company, the publishers, because I only knew them as they would send me books and say, the translator is. But this book has done great in Czechoslovakia, any foreign country you can name. What How and where did you get with them?
They're a very cool company. The company's called Europa Editions, and they're an Italian company based in Rome, and they're quite successful in Europe. And they decided to have an American branch in which they would publish mostly European authors in translation. And they publish a very small handful of American authors, one of whom is Steve Erickson, a terrific writer who lives here in Los Angeles. And I became affiliated with Europa when I showed Steve my last manuscript, a book called The Angry Buddhist, and Steve showed it to his editor at Europa, Kent Carroll, and Kent responded to The Angry Buddhist and became my editor, and they published that, and then they published I Regret Everything.
That's interesting. So, again, connections?
Absolutely.
And will they be doing your next book?
We'll see.
Yeah. But I love that whole idea of Europa and the fact that they're making inroads here.
Yeah, and they do an interesting thing. They publish, I forget what the style is called, but it's basically European paperbacks. It's the way all the books in France are published, for example. It's a paperback, but it has a flyleaf. It's a very elegant design. It retails for about $15 or $16. And, given how expensive books have become, it seems to be a good business model for them. And they publish literary fiction and high-end crime fiction, and they seem to be thriving, as far as I can tell.
Well, the books are excellent.
They are.
Even if they're translated, I have enjoyed reading, whether it's Red Joan or some of the other books that they have out.
They published something called The Elegance of the Hedgehog, a French novel by a writer called Muriel Barbary, I believe is her name. Mm-hmm. And that sold about 100,000 copies for them. So they have books that do really well, too.
All right. Now tell me, Zane, what is the future for Spalding?
What is the future for Spalding? That's a really good question. She, I think, as a result of what she's been through with the story, is going to have I won't say a happy life, but I think she's going to have a creative life. She has an inner strength that she didn't have when the story began, and she's been forged by her experience. She's been through, in the book, one of these experiences that can either forge you or crush you, and I would like to think that she's been forged by it. So I'm cautiously optimistic about Spalding Simonson.
Do your children, I know they're not children anymore, do they read and get involved? Because you thank some people for having really read all the various parts of the book.
Yeah, they've read, if you mean do they get involved with this book, my daughter has read this book. My son, as far as I know, has not read it yet. I suspect he might, but I don't want to put any pressure on him.
But all of the people you do mention, they have read various forms of it.
I will say this, though. My wife read many drafts of this book and was instrumental in getting it to the place that it's been or that it is. And when we were talking earlier, before we went on the air, you used the adjective pointillistic to describe the book, which I think is a terrific adjective to describe it, in that it's created really of a series of emotional moments. And the way they connect really determines how well the book works or doesn't work. And one of the things that my wife, who has an amazing editorial eye, was able to do for me was, in the course of the many rewrites, make sure that those emotional beats were really connecting in the most powerful way. And I'm deeply in debt to her for the work she put in this process.
Yeah, because it is emotional, and it is where it goes brick by brick by brick. Yeah.
It does, yeah, and you need readers in the rewriting process for that, because that's a very, very difficult thing, I think, almost, for me, an impossible thing to do alone.
Did they have editors here in this country?
Yeah, Kent Carroll edited the book, and he had sub-editors who worked on it as well, and I had good support from Europa during the process.
Well, in which case, I thank them, because they have a new fan in me, and would you sign my book?
I would be happy to, and thank you very much for having me on the show.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. But also visit us at visit us at Claremont Graduate University Digital Library. They have the first 2,000 shows we ever did, but they are digitized, because if you don't digitize tape library, they will disintegrate, and that would be a crime to do to some very important people who wrote wonderful books such as Irving Wallace, Norman Mailer, etc. But this show you've just seen will be on YouTube in about a week. But meanwhile, support your local library. Go in, take out a card. That is how they get funding. Take a child with you. They will never forget you. Where'd you get your first library card?
I love that question. At the public library in the town I grew up in when I was probably 5 years old.
What town did you
go? Scarsdale, New York. A beautiful old stone building built probably in the 1920s. And I worked there. My first paying job when I was in, I think I was a freshman in high school, I was 14 years old, was working at the Scarsdale Public Library.
And there is no better library, and I have a sister who lives there and worked at Pace University running their bookstore. But meanwhile, we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Seth.
Thanks again for having me.
See you next time.